Praise God. It's a big deal, isn't it, Calvary?
Amen.
Amen. I tell you what, it'll move your heart if you'll ever get there. Amen. Really kneel at that place where Christ, amen, has paid the price for all sins.
Amen.
At the cross where I first saw the light.
Amen.
Where it was there that sin's power over me was taken away. Hallelujah. Amen. You know, as Brother Seville had gotten in contact with us and about ministering on the forgiveness, amen, that verse there in Luke chapter 23 and verse 34, amen. Then said Jesus, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do.
Amen.
And they parted his raiment and cast lots. Amen. And I know we have a little bit of time here. Amen. But as that word was just burning on my heart a week and a half, a couple of weeks ago, that's all I've been thinking about. Amen. It's the forgiveness of God. Amen. At a point that he was on the cross now, when he begins to say these things, amen. And it was after the part where he had gotten beaten and scourged and whipped and slapped and the crown of thorns and spit upon and mocked and name calling, all the beaten almost beyond the point of recognition.
Right.
And there he is able to say, Father, forgive them.
Hallelujah.
For they know not what they do.
Yes.
What kind of a man is this Jesus Christ?
Hallelujah.
Whom we have fallen in love with. Amen. You know, as she sang that song, I just pictured the Lord saying, you know, the cross is going to be hell. It's going to be hard. It's going to be bloody. It's a serious thing, this emblem of suffering and shame.
Right.
Amen. But you know what? Jesus, I believe, looked ahead in time and said, it's going to be worth it, though.
Amen.
Amen. Kern Fiddler is going to be my best friend.
Hallelujah.
John Andrews is going to be my best friend.
Praise God.
Amen. I'm going to have fellowship, real close fellowship, with Jeff Dismore, Brother James Hawk, amen, and all the brothers that are here. I don't have time to mention every name, but think about how much he cares for us and how much he loves us, amen. But the sweetest words I've ever heard was, I forgive, amen. And I'll never forget that night. I'm so glad for that night, amen, when I cried out to God, repenting of all my sin and so sorry. Amen. Telling the Lord how sorry I was for running. Amen. Not serving him. Amen. And how I begged him, if he'd deliver me from alcohol, amen, that I would serve him the rest of my life. Amen. That was my prayer. I didn't know a whole lot about God. Then I knew Jesus was the way. I was crying out to him, please, Lord, somehow. I know you can't drink alcohol and be serving the Lord, but I need to be delivered of that. If you can do that for me.
Yes.
I will do my best to serve you the rest of my sober, clean life.
Praise God.
Instantaneously, I was forgiven.
Praise God.
And I knew it. Amen. I knew it that night, amen, that God had delivered me and forgiven me. Amen. As I repented of all the evil and all the sins that I've gotten into. Amen. But it still blows my mind after all of these years how instant it was.
Praise
amen.
God.
That he forgave me. And what through the blood of Jesus Christ washed all my sins away. Didn't hold nothing against me. No grudges with the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Now looking back and the things that I've learned now, as though I've never sinned.
Praise God.
Isn't that awesome to know? We serve an awesome Savior. Amen. Amen. And again, there on that cross, amen, he paid a debt he did not owe, and I owed a debt that I could never pay. But because of the blood of Jesus Christ, amen. 2,000 years later, here we are, still getting teary-eyed, amen. Kenny Hinson sung a song, he said, I'll never be over the hill, amen. I'll never be over Calvary, amen. For it was there that sin's power over me was taken away.
Praise God.
Amen. But the key to forgiveness, I got to tell you this, Christian, I got to tell you this, friend, is repentance.
Right.
Amen. We must repent. And then the blood of Jesus Christ is able to wash all sin from our lives. Aren't you glad it's that way? Amen. That we can be delivered. Amen. Looking back now, and I know I got to hurry, but looking back now, I believe he was waiting for me that night in prison. Amen. For a long time, but at that night, in that moment, I repented.
Praise God.
Instantly forgave him. Amen. I'm so glad. Here he is interceding for all those, amen, that were there on that day, and all of us that would live all these 2,000 years later, and how long this thing goes, amen. God knows, I believe he's coming soon, but he was interceding, amen, for you and I.
Yes.
Just a quick story, then I'll close. I remember my dad was kind of tired of me drinking and just carrying on and not showing up for work, and I was a loser. I just was a total loser, and he had helped me get a place, and he used to threaten me if I don't go to work, he's going to sell the place. And I remember he told me this story years later after my grandfather died, my grandfather Isaac Fiddler, and how my dad was telling his dad, my grandpa, I just got to sell the place. He's never going to straighten up. He's never going to change. My grandpa said, just give him a little bit of time. Jesus. You know how you were. You know how I was. Just give Kerm a little bit more time. Oh, when I just thought about that, I thought about my Lord. And how Jesus was interceding for me before the Father. And judgment was inevitable. And it was coming. It was coming fast. It was coming hard. But Jesus said, just, Father, just a little bit more time. I almost got it. I believe he's coming to the end of it. Oh, I'm so glad.
Thank you, Jesus.
Amen. That the blood of Jesus Christ. Amen. I know I'm not perfect yet, but I will be.
Yes.
Amen. And he has brought me a long way. I'm so glad. Amen. For Jesus Christ and his mercy. Amen. The Bible says that Jesus gave that illustration of forgiveness 490 times in a day. I had a mathematician figure it out, amen, so we ought to know what he's talking about. But it's 3 times every minute. It's almost impossible to get offended that much, which I believe Jesus Christ must have been before he hung on that cross and while he was on that cross. But he's a forgiver.
Amen.
He loves you.
Amen.
He's given all that he had for you to forgive you. Amen. That's how much the Lord is ready to forgive sin and sinners. Amen. And I love that verse there. To whom much is forgiven, the same loveth much.
Amen. Amen.
I love the Lord tonight.
Amen.
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 I'd like to thank Pastor Seville for this opportunity to minister. Truly is an honor and privilege to stand behind the sacred text. Why don't we just bow our heads for one moment in prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, we give you all praise and glory for everything you've done for us and shall continue to do. Lord, we thank you that your God who reigns on high, that there's none like you, Lord. Now, even right now, we rebuke every attack of the enemy that may come our way tonight and pray that you set your angels at the four corners of the property above and below, that no attack of the enemy may penetrate. I pray that you touch all of our hearts and our minds, that we would receive your word, but also that us as ministers would be able to bring forth your word and bring forth the words you have us to hear. We ask all these things in the name of Jesus. Amen.
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 Tonight, as we're looking at the words of Jesus Christ, if we would only get an image of what's going on here, we would find that there is a focal point outside the east gate of Jerusalem on a hill called Golgotha. And all around there is a spectacle going on. Up in heaven, the Father's looking down on the Son hanging on the cross, maybe almost with me, knowing what is going about to happen there. Perhaps the angels are looking down, Brother Dismore, looking in, inquiring into the salvation experience that they know nothing of. Oh, as we get a little bit closer to earth, I can only imagine that the demons and the principalities and the powers and the kingdoms and princes of the heavens are looking down from the throne, sitting on their edge seat. Perhaps the demons on this earth are swirling around the outer gate of Jerusalem, looking on there as they are waiting for the Son of God to die, the whole goal that they've been waiting from the very time that he was born. So many times we look at this passage and we don't realize what is going on. In Luke chapter 23 and verse 43, we find the words of Jesus Christ as he states to the thief on the cross, today shalt thou be with me in paradise. Oh, as we look at this scene, we see the prophecy of Isaiah unfolding in Isaiah chapter 53 and verse 12, which states, therefore did I divide him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he hath poured out his soul unto death. And get this, And he was numbered with the transgressors. He bare the sin of many and made intercession for the transgressors. As we look here at this passage, we see a conversation between Jesus Christ and one of the transgressors there on the cross. Oh, it is so fun, Brother David. Sometimes we call it to preach the words of Jesus Christ on the cross, and we get emphatic, and we get charismatic. But if we would take things into perspective, Brother Andrew, and realize what's really going on, I'm doubtful if they said things that were wasteful, Brother Kern. But every word that those crucified victims said was very meaningful to each one of them, because they had to push up and take a breath to utter the word. Oh, we may utter it out, "Today thou shalt be with me in paradise." But if we would take it into reality, it might be more along the lines, "Today shalt thou be with me in paradise." Oh, those words were probably more painful for Christ to utter than we would ever dream or imagine. And if we would only take them into consideration and take into those consideration those words, he said, "Today shalt thou be with me in paradise." Not "today shall I be with you in paradise," but "today you shall be with me in paradise." What is Jesus saying? He was showing right there on the cross that there is only one way to heaven. I am the way maker. If I have to reiterate it time and time again, the words of Jesus in John chapter 14 and verse 6, where he says, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." Jesus in this passage was showing to everyone there that he was the only way. And that he was going to precede the thief into paradise. See, a way maker doesn't wait for somebody else to go before them. But they are the one that trail, and they blaze the way for everybody else. They aren't the one that takes the easy path and follows behind. They don't fall behind the broken bushes of thorns and thistles, but rather they are the one that cuts them back. They are the ones that bend them with their own hands. They take the brunt of it. They take the brunt of the force, and they are the ones willing to do it when no one else is willing to do it. And Jesus was saying, "I am the way."
Hallelujah.
As we look into this, what we're going on through tonight, as we take communion, there is only one way into heaven tonight. And we remember that through the precious blood of Jesus Christ. In Ephesians chapter 2 and verses 8 and 9, the Apostle Paul wrote that it doesn't matter what you do in this life. It doesn't matter how good you are, Brother Dismar. It's not going to get you into heaven. It doesn't matter what you accomplish. It doesn't matter what your title is, Brother Peterman. There's only one way into heaven. You know, you get all your good deeds account for nothing. There's only one way, and that is through the blood of Jesus Christ. The Apostle Paul, if you want to assume that he's the writer of Hebrews, state, even back to Moses. Moses, the blood of bulls and goats, they're not going to get you into heaven. They're not going to pay the way for you. There is only one way, and that is through the blood of Jesus Christ. You see, that is exactly what Jesus was showing right here in this passage. There is only one way into heaven. And today, I am going to pay the price before you even pass away. Before you die on this tree, I will go before you. And I will make a way through my own precious blood that you may be with me in paradise. You see, there's something going on in this passage. That morning, that thief, he was an enemy of Caesar. But in the evening, he was a friend of God, Brother Dismar. That morning, Brother Val, he was a sinner. He was far from God. But while the other thief mocked him and said, "If you're really Jesus, why don't you save yourself?" The other thief that spoke up said, "You don't realize who he is. You don't realize who he is, and I need him. Lord, I know I can't go where you're going, but remember me when you get there." And Jesus said, "This day I'm going to make the way for you. This day my blood is going to pay the price, and you will be with me in paradise." Oh, what does that mean for us who have accepted Jesus Christ as our personal Savior, who are covered with the precious blood of Jesus Christ? That, well, though our sins might have once been scarlet, now they are white as snow. Oh, Savior, a friend of God.
Amen.
Oh, well, we might have been out of the family, God. Oh, now we are a son or a daughter, God, because of the precious blood of Jesus Christ. But he did not stop there. We are joint heirs in Jesus Christ. We are promised a little bit of that and given a guarantee and a little bit of taste of the earnest of the inheritance of the Holy Ghost. Oh, and what did he say to the thief on the cross? This day shall you be with me in paradise. Oh, from heaven, God speaks down to the saints. Oh, you're not going to be with me in paradise. But I told you before that I will go away and prepare a place for you, that where I am, you may be all with me also. I've got to make a way for you. And it's got to be something more great than you can ever imagine. And we all know that as saints of the living God, as we look at our eyes gaze towards the eastern sky, that there's coming a moment when death would not know the sentence. Where the sting of the grave won't be able to touch us, Brother Dinsmore. But the children of God will be caught up to meet our Lord in the air. Wherefore we shall forever be with the Lord. And why is that possible? Because of the precious blood of Jesus, that he made himself the way maker, the sacrificial lamb for you and I. Oh, as we get ready to have communion tonight, let us not forget the preciousness of the blood of the Lamb.
Yeah.
For it hath made the way into the Holy of Holies, where God himself ripped the veil from top to bottom. I said, come on in a little bit closer. I want you to see me. I want you to talk to me a little bit closer. Yeah. And it's all because of the precious Lamb of God.
Amen.
Why don't we lift our hands tonight?
Praise God.
Here tonight and see everybody.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Brothers, for both the opportunity to speak. Reading from John chapter 19 tonight, and beginning at verse 25, even though it says 27 there, I want to back up a little bit. And the Bible says, now there stood by the cross of Jesus his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Cleophas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus therefore saw his mother and the disciple standing by whom he loved, he saith unto his mother, Woman, behold thy son. Then said he to the disciple, Behold thy mother. And from that hour the disciple took her unto his own home. When Brother Seville asked me to minister, I began to look into some study helps and things and try to see what God's trying to say to us in this verse, because I don't believe anything's ever said in Scripture that's in vain. Can you say amen?
That's right.
And so we see one of the most beautiful ideas and surely a passage that we could ever find in the Bible, believe it or not, here. Jesus was saying some pretty profound things that first of all, and most importantly, at least in this moment, is that he really cared for his mother. And that tells me if he cared for his mother, he cares for you.
Amen.
You see, Jesus realized that when Mary was going through this, it was a horrible thing for her. For she saw his abuse, she saw his torture, she saw his crucifixion. And being a mother as she was tormented he was tormented, in a sense, in her spirit. And her heart bled the same as the wounds in his body bled.
Amen.
She had a mother's heart that really was concerned for this son of hers. You see, I want you to know that Jesus tonight understands when you lose somebody that's close to you.
Amen.
He understands that. And he understood what Mary was going to have to face and go through. And he understood that this woman was really suffering, but in a different way than he was, but yet still suffering.
Sure, come on, Brother Jonathan.
You see, the eternal love of a mother and of motherhood is in Mary at the cross.
Right.
I said the eternal love of motherhood is in Mary at the cross. A mother is always a mother. And I know this is a Mother's Day's message, but it fits in as I was thinking about this. Notice in verse 26 that when Jesus saw his mother there, it says that he saw her and the disciple standing by whom he loved. He said unto her, "Woman, behold thy son." Why did he say woman instead of mom? Because really, she was suffering enough already. And he wanted to try to ease the suffering to some degree. But yet, on the other hand, that if you studied out, this woman, this term woman, was also a term and son many times that was one of honor. So he was giving honor to this woman as well. And so I titled the message tonight, when he was seeing his mother go through this tonight, he was looking ahead, the days ahead. And so I titled the message tonight, Thinking of the Days Ahead. Amen. You know, the Lord's thinking ahead for you.
Amen.
He thought ahead when he reached out and saw you in a lost condition, as someone else said tonight.
Amen.
He was looking ahead to the time when you would need him and realize how much you really didn't need him.
Amen.
You see, all the disciples at this point had fled. They had all deserted Jesus, and the only one that was left was John.
Right.
Something you need to understand in the scripture here tonight is that it's made reference that there was a disciple there in verse 26, and the disciple standing by. It didn't say disciples. It said disciple, and it specifically denotes that there was a man named John there. Now, this John was one that we know from scripture was called John the Beloved. In fact, he wrote the Gospel of John.
Right.
But there was a needed reference here in the fact that John was the son of Salome. And Salome was the sister of Mary, the birth mother of Jesus, the Virgin Mary. And so here she was, and here was John, and so Mary's sister was going to be singled out, and even in the agony of the cross. This moment at the cross when Jesus was suffering himself, Jesus was thinking ahead to Mary.
Amen.
He was thinking about Mary. This is something our Savior never really concerns himself with himself. It's always about us.
Wow.
Not very long ago at church I was talking about if there's one thing that epitomizes Jesus and puts it all in a nutshell, that it was never about himself, it was always about you. It was about me, it was about others. There's one word that can describe Jesus, it would be others. And you're that other tonight. He's concerned, and he went to a cross because of that. But here he was concerned about this one, his mother Mary. And Jesus thought of the loneliness of that mother. When you lose somebody, you're going to be lonely if they're near to you. You've buried people and had loved ones and friends go, and there's a loneliness that only God can heal there. He realized the loneliness of his mother's heart, and so he looked the days ahead. He looked not only the days ahead, but moments ahead. When he turned to John and said, John, I want you to take care of this woman, in essence. I want you to take care of her. No, she's not your mother. But from this day forward, she's going to be your mother. And you, mom, you, mother, you, woman, are to take him as your son. And so there was a healing to be there. He was interested in what would become of my mom. What would become of Mary, if we could say it that way. Doesn't that say that Jesus was thinking ahead to somebody else? He was thinking of the sorrows of others other than himself and of his own. Certainly he was in sorrow, certainly he was in pain, certainly he was in torture, but it was always about the other. He directed Mary to look upon John, as we said, as a son, even though really he truly was only her nephew. And Jesus taught us something here. And I wondered if there would be people tonight that would want to hear this. So on my back porch getting my notes and studying this afternoon, I thought there might be some people not want to hear this, but it may seem old-fashioned because of the way the world is today, but you know what? God says to us, if you want the blessing of God, if you want to live a long life, then you take care of your parents. It's just the way it is. He was saying, take care of this woman. She Jesus taught us to provide for the comfort of the aged parents. Not long ago, I was talking to somebody about how it was when I was growing up. I know I'm an old fuddy-duddy compared to some of the younger ones here tonight, but you see, it was not uncommon to see grandparents and great-grandparents being kept in the same house with their loved ones who were younger, their children, and were kept there and taken care of. There was not much nursing home going on. Not that nursing homes are wrong, but they took care of them. They cared about them. Many times I meet people that are old and up in years, I would say elderly years, I don't want to say old, but elderly years, and I think, you know, I wonder why they live so long, but I wonder if it's not possible that they were good to their parents. Come on. So, in closing today, this was an honor put upon John. This was truly an honor. My parents are a hassle. Come on now. Get over it. Pray it through.
Yes.
Even if you can't keep them in your house, honor them.
Yes.
It's an honor to put upon, John. It was a testimony. It was a testimony to John, this one, because of his prudence and his fidelity. He had character, godly character. And John was not just randomly picked. Jesus was looking for somebody that would handle the job well. He wants you to handle the job well, whatever he puts in your hand to do. And John cheerfully and gladly said, well, he didn't really say it, but the scripture says there, he took her to his own home. His own home. He took it upon him, his own self. He cheerfully and gladly accepted the opportunity. My last thought for you is tonight, he's saying to us, to do a service for Christ.
Amen.
Our life now is not our own as Christians. We're here to do a service for Him. As I said about Jesus, it was always about the other. Serving you. Now is your opportunity to give back to Him.
When Jesus first began to speak on the cross, it was the sixth hour. And now we come to the ninth hour. So come close with me to the cross today. Listen to what the Savior is saying here in Matthew 27, verse 46. And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani? That is to say, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? This is a passage of scripture that is often discussed, debated in Bible school. You could debate just about anything. You know that? For very long periods of time. But the scripture tells us what's happening. This here, in this passage, we see a crescendo of suffering. And crescendo is a musical term, a gradual increase in loudness or intensity. See, at the cross, he suffered spiritually, physically, and emotionally. There was a war going on at the cross. For him to spoil principalities and powers, in his cross, there was a battle going on. There was a battle with the devil. But there was a battle with the Father. And all of this began, we can probably trace it back even to the week before, but let's now take a little trip to the Passover meal. And we see that this pressure is beginning to mount. And he says, and as they did eat, he said, verily I say unto you, that one of you shall betray me. Betrayal is tough. And might I tell you tonight, Christian, I mean this to encourage you, not to scare you, but you're really not worth your salt until you've been betrayed. If I want to be like him, I have to suffer with him. And the suffering of betrayal stings and it hurts. David had that.
with that song.
Oh, if it had only been somewhat other than someone who said it, my own tape. And that's where betrayal always is. I've been betrayed. And it hurts.